मुकं करोति वाचालं पंगुं लंघायते गिरी यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे श्रीगुरुदिनतारिणम् ओम अज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति सरुदमदर स्वामिति नामिनी नमो सद्भक्तमने मणिपुरुद्भवे च प्रभुपादलस्य दवाणि प्रचार निरताय ते पूज्य श्री गुरुवर्ग वंदित महाभावान्वित सदा पूर्वापर्य परंपरा प्रचलित प्राच्य प्रमुखाकिते भक्तिर निर्मल निर्जर सन्निवृतम संरक्षकम सादरम वंदे श्री गुरुदेव नाथ शिलाचार्य वर्जम निजम गुरुवाविष्ट सुप्रकम गुरुगणैराशीष संभूषितम चिंता चिंत समस्त भेद निपुणम श्री रूप पंथानुगम गोविंद विदम उज्जलम भरतनम भक्तर्मितम सुंदरम वंदे विश्व गुरुम च दिव्य भगवत प्रेम न ही बीज पदम अतनत्व मंत्र गुरुन गुरुन भागवतार्थदान व्यासान जगत गुरु नत्व तत जय मुदिरये वृंदाये तुलसी देव्याय प्रियाय केशवस्य च कृष्ण भक्ति पदे देवी सत्यवते नमः नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासादि श्री गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। धन्यवाद प्रणाम टू ऑल द डिवोटीज वैष्णवस बाय द ग्रेस ऑफ गुरु गोरंग बाय ऑल योर ग्रेस वी कुड डू सम हंबल सर्विस ऑफ द टीचिंग्स ऑफ अ गुरु वर्ग। धन्यवाद कृष्ण केंद्र प्रभु
गुजरात
very close to Dwarka, huh? Which department you work there? What you do?
I was in ISRO.
Okay.
And now I am retired.
Okay. Very nice. We always give the example how we can launch a satellite and predict its trajectory. But when we release a living bird, there is no law which can predict where the bird will go. Can ISRO tell us where the bird will go after release at a certain angle? Can ISRO tell us? Do they have any law?
Birds are migrating, having some certain knowledge.
Yes.
And they are using different just like sun, moon and stars for getting direction.
It is being told when there is a programmed car is moving, it is very easy to predict where the car will go. But the car is being driven by a person, no law can tell where the person will go. Why it is so? Why life is difficult to predict, what life has, something that, you know, science is facing difficulty to predict its activity.
But astrologers are predicting something.
Yeah. But still they cannot predict the...
Not 100% correct.
Yes. Why it is so? Do you know? Do you know what is the reason?
No, I don't know.
So this is the problem in our modern education. It does not tell us that we are only studying matter. We are not studying anything about life. Life has a quality that is freedom, free will. Bird has its own freedom, its own free will. Self-determination, it is called in philosophy. It is not determined by any law. It is determined by its own will, free will. And that has no predictability in terms of any laws. Otherwise, it is not free will. It is some determined thing. Because of our lack of knowledge of discriminating between life and non-life, the whole of, you know, modern society, civilization is suffering, actually. We are trying to find the solution for the life in matter. But matter is by nature dull. It does not have any purpose. It does not have freedom. It does not seek happiness, fulfillment, or anything. A bunch of molecules or a extremely complex satellite has no desire of its own. It has no desire. It has no goal of its own. The goal is outside. The person decides. But every living entity has its own goal, what it wants to do. Self, that is known as Kant, Immanuel Kant, you know, Western philosophy. Immanuel Kant, he told nature jwek. So there is an internal teleology. Life has internal teleology. Telo means purpose. Life has internal teleology. And machines have external teleology, mechanical objects. It is the designer or the owner decides what the machine must do. So this basic difference is being not even educated to the people. But our scriptures, they begin with, you know, this very fundamental principle of understanding the difference between life and matter. Today also we wanted to discuss how do we understand what the scriptures are really trying to say. It's not that, you know, scriptures we read and understand them. Just reading like that, that's not going to helpful. Just by reading. If one person read one book, another person reads the same book, they understand it differently. Then what is the correct understanding? That is not going to come from directly from scripture like that. So we need a person there. A person, a teacher, is teaching the same thing to all his students. But all students, they're not getting the same type of understanding. They all understand differently. Why it is so? Why it is all not all electrons same? According to science, say all electrons are same. If you ask which electron you are talking about, they have no way to tell which electron is that. All electrons have same nature. But life is not like that. Life has individuality. You cannot put one apple plus another apple and it is two apple. Like that equation will not work because they are not identical. One and another one is identical. But here, one apple and another apple cannot be similar, same in all respect. There may be some different shape. They may be of different taste. There may be, you know, something is more ripened than another apple. Some may be another, you know, variety than this apple. Not all same. So the mentality of making all same, that is not correct. Even one scripture is there, but understanding of people are all different. There may be one religion, but that practitioner of that religion, maybe they all have different conception of that religion. It is not all same. So this mentality of trying to make everything one is the disease of modern civilization. It's a disease. They want to make all seeds one. You know that? The farmers are facing the problem of seed diversity. Previously, they were preserving the seeds by themselves. And then the diversity was, you know, maintained. But now, they all want to make it, you know, mechanized kind of thing. And the diversity is lost. Then they are facing problem with the crops and insect and so many other, you know, problems are coming. There are so many research on that. How to get back again, you know, that seed diversity. So many such issues are coming. Everybody wants to become collector. Everybody wants to become engineer. But who wants to become farmer? Who wants to become, you know, doing that in a manual job? Nobody wants. So that type of mentality of, you know, making everything same is the suffering condition has been created in the society. The unity in diversity principle has been completely forgotten. And our scriptures does not encourage that, all making all same. It maintains the variety and yet it can have common goal. It's possible. Like for example, we may have so many organs in our body. Nose, eyes, kidney, heart, all these things. They may be all different organs and they have different functions. And yet, they are all united in body. They are all united in body. Serving the common goal. Keeping the body in a proper functioning form. They are all working like that. That is known as organic whole. Organic holism, that philosophy. Our scriptures are teaching about the philosophy of organic holism. There may be diversity, but there is also unity. Like our eyes, hands, leg, everything united for the common goal, for the well-being of the body, for the interest of the body as a whole. And then how the whole reality that is there in front of us, the moons, the stars, galaxies, the atoms, molecules, different living entities. What is the unity of all of that? Are the unity just some gravity, some strong force, weak force, all these things, some chemical bonding? Or there is another unity exist between all these entities that is we are experiencing in front of us? What is that uniting principle? Does anybody have any idea about that? What could be the uniting principle for all of these things that is there in front of us? What is uniting them? What principle is uniting them? How we can understand the unity?
Dandavat Pranam Maharaj. So, four fundamental forces, Maharaj.
That's what modern science is thinking.
Yes.
But you see, can your eye, leg, hand, everything unite by their force?
For a living thing, it is sentience.
But I'm saying the reality. They have a question whether universe is living or non-living. They're asking this question. Whether universe is living or non-living. Many scientists are asking this. Because universe is not something, sitting there. It is also expanding and contracting also. Whether it is living or non-living. And what is uniting everything? Universe even beyond. What is that unity?
It's only...
We can say consciousness, Maharaj.
Yes. So how we can see that principle working? How we can see that principle working? The unity. Scientists are trying to find the unity in terms of forces.
Yes.
They see that two planets, they are related to each other by some force called gravity. That is their explanation. But Newton, he was also thinking before that the kind of movement that is going on in the planetary system that would not sustain so long if there is no maintaining principle, such a zigzag way with such high speed, if they are moving, the chaos theory later on developed. And if the laws that has been described in science that has to be followed, then they must collide with each other actually. But they are not colliding. They keep on going for so many ages actually. What is that maintaining? If the ordinary law we allow in the body, it will be very highly difficult to tell what kind of force, that inert force, dull forces can maintain such complex function in the body. The cells, how complex, even one cell, forget about the body. Even one cell is such a complex thing. The cell has to recognize the environment. It has to recognize its food. And inside its environment, it has to separate different reactions. If that reactions are not separated, it will create some unwanted products. So where is the intelligence coming in those, reactions? What is, separating one reaction from another for avoiding unwanted products? Where is the intelligence in the chemicals? There is nothing happens like that in the non-living reality. So what is that is organizing, order is producing. Previously they are thinking, following Descartes, that only humans are conscious, human beings are conscious. And later on, in 2011 or 12, I think, there was a conference at Cambridge University. And they have a declaration, Cambridge Declaration on consciousness. They have declared, you can search Cambridge Declaration on Consciousness. Stephen Hawking was also present. And it is declared that human to octopus, all non-human animals, they are also conscious entities. And there are many scientists, many big biologists, they are saying that cell is also conscious. One of the prominent among them is James Shapiro. Ben Jacob, he passed away, but Ben Jacob has a lot of papers published on that. How bacteria, even unicell organism, single cell organism, but he's highly intelligent. He's highly intelligent. And they have communication among each other. Same way like we living, like colony, they're living with each other. Where that intelligence is coming? If they are just dull atoms and molecules, from where that intelligence is coming? That, if we can understand, then we see how the universal consciousness is acting. We have our consciousness, no doubt, but there is another consciousness that is, even if you observe your body, that is maintaining it. There is something called autonomous signal. Autonomous. It is does not have control over them. It works automatically, actually. And how that is working. From where that intelligence is coming, that consciousness is coming. And how that consciousness is uniting the entire principle. That our scriptures are teaching. Our scriptures are not teaching some superficial these laws. Guess. One person is guessing one thing, another person is guessing another thing. It's not like that. And scriptures are not man-made. It's not that, one professor is writing a book. That is not the way scriptures manifest. That's not the way. Valmiki, he written entire Ramayana before Lord Ram even came to perform his pastime. How he could write that? How he can write that? So that higher consciousness can reveal its plan, can reveal its process of approaching to the absolute in the heart of a pure devotee. And through that devotee, we can, get the proper understanding of things. And the same scriptures may be there from ages, but the understanding may be different as the time moves according to people's consciousness, people's development. The things are given in different way according to their ability to realize things. Maybe the same mathematics you're studying in class 1, class 2, and a PhD also. But the level of that mathematics is completely different in those classes. The same mathematics maybe you're studying. The same thing for religious scriptures. It is given in installment to an individual. According to time, place, circumstances. According to the time, place, and circumstances. So this is most important thing. Do you all agree what we have been discussing here? Or anybody have any questions or comments on what we are saying? So the understanding of transcendental truth is not coming from our own mundane ability. Even our knowledge, if somebody speak to us, even our knowledge, that does not come from us. Matte smutir jnanam aparam. Krishna has to give that intelligence to you to understand it. Otherwise, you don't understand it. Krishna has to give that intelligence. We are thinking we are the subject and everything else is the object. I can understand, I can know. But you are the object of that supreme object, supreme subject. You are the object. Then what kind of approach is necessary there? It's not that I can know. It is not possible there. I don't know. That is the way of starting the spiritual progress. I don't know. I have no ability to know by my own. But another approach, the aggressive approach, I can understand everything. That's what Descartes told. Try to find the secret of the nature and try to rule over nature. But are we ruling over nature or nature ruling on us? You just see what is happening. Just observe it. Are we ruling nature or nature ruling us? What do you say? What do you say?
Nature ruling us.
You are thinking we have so much advanced knowledge, atomic knowledge, atomic power, so much space technology we have developed, and yet a small, tiny, this virus keeping the entire world in quarantine, in home quarantine. See how this nature is powerful, how much power it has. Your atom bombs cannot do anything there. If earthquake comes, what kind of science can stop? What kind of science can stop? The natural calamity will come. Anybody stop? They cannot stop. They may predict, oh, this will happen, that will happen. That's okay. But you cannot stop it. You cannot stop. You have no control over nature. Nature is making you slave. Nature is making you slave. You are thinking you can enslave nature. That's why the idea of Descartes is. But nature is always telling, no, you are my slave. You are my slave. Prakriti. You are servant of Prakriti. So how to come out of that Prakriti? Slavery of that Prakriti. What is possible? What is the process? How to come out of that slavery? The Prakriti is enslaving us. How to come out of that? What is the process? Anybody knows? Thakkarji, do you know what is the process? Come out of the slavery of this Prakriti, nature?
Bhakti, Maharaj. Bhakti, the process, 9 processes of devotional service.
Yes. You have to become slave of, servant of, the master of the Prakriti. Then the Prakriti can be controlled. Rishikesa, Rishikeno, Sevanam, Bhakti. You have to serve the master of the senses. The master of the Prakriti. Mayadhyakshena Prakriti Seyate Characharam. Mayadhyakshena. In his direction. Mameva Prapadyante, Mayameti, Tarantite. Who surrender to me, they can cross over this illusionary environment. Mama Maya Durottaya. My illusion cannot be crossed. You are thinking by this discovery of some this tiny guesses of laws you are proud of. You can control Prakriti? You cannot. You cannot control Prakriti. Neither you can be free from that. You have to know very complex, integrate way this Prakriti is working. Sakti Saktiman, the Saktibad philosophy explains. Krishna is Saktiman. Saktiman, Sakti Saktiman. Krishna is Saktiman. And Prakriti, he is his external energy. Mahamaya. Bahiranga Sakti. And we living entities, also his energy. What kind of energy is that? Anybody knows?
Tatastha
Sakti. Marginal potency. And in the spiritual world, there is another potency. What is that name of that potency?
Antaranga Sakti.
Yes, Antaranga Sakti. Jogamaya. So internal energy, external energy, and marginal energy. So Prakriti is external energy, jivas are marginal energy, and Yogamaya is the internal energy. So we are in the border. And to go into any side, towards the side of Mahamaya, that domain, or towards the yoga maya's domain, spiritual world or material world. Both the thing, you need some association, some force. Some force is necessary. And that force comes from association. What kind of association you are taking? From there, you go to either Mahamaya side or Yogamaya side. It is not by your power that you can go there. Because you are in marginal border. And you are having the option, that's why. To go this side or that side. That is the free will, freedom. That is the free will you have. What you want to choose? You want to choose the side of illusion? To live in the side of illusion? Thinking yourself the dominator, controller? Okay, go ahead. Try your best. Everybody is trying. Scientists also trying. Not only that. Even some so-called religionists, they're also saying, I am the greatest. I am now become Narayan. Some are saying, I have become Narayan now. Some are saying, I am a great religious leader. Why should I, care anybody else? All these things coming up. So many types of egos. That is not going to help. Real religion teach us humility, our insignificance. We are so insignificant before that divine plane. We cannot aggressively poke our nose to that plane. We cannot approach that. That plane is only approachable by the mood of humility, humble nature. How much humble the devotees, Prahlad Maharaj, how much humble. Even Hanuman, such powerful devotee, but how much humble he is. How much humble. Those great, great personalities. Anantadev, endless hoods, and holding all this universe like a mustard seed. And how much humility he is showing, bowing down before the Absolute. And we jivas, even insignificant in that mustard seed, in that universe, yet we don't want to accept the superiority of the Absolute. Even we are not ant, compared to ant before Ananda says. We are so insignificant. And we are so proud. I already figured out. I am now a devotee, or I am now a scientist. I have figured out everything. I know how things are happening. The great, great personality saying, they don't know how things are working. They don't know how Lord is doing. Nobody knows. He is the mystic. The supreme mystic, actually. Not only any mystic. The supreme mystic. He puts great, great mystics even in illusion. Great, great mystics are deluded by him. Madan Mohan. The Cupid who deludes the jivas, and millions of such Cupids are deluded by Krishna. Such personality. How we can approach? How we can know him? He not left us without any direction. He has given us scriptures and given us also teachers who can teach about those scriptures, the real understanding of those scriptures. He not left us in this world to do research and know things, searching here, there, finding, this is maybe my father's bone. No, this is not like looking like my father's bone. No, that is another, that bone may be my father's bone. Like that, guessing things. It's not the way to know things. It's not the way to know the truth. You cannot know by that process. You have to be helped. That help Lord has given, Absolute has given, by giving God the scriptures. And those inner meanings of those scriptures are revealed in the heart of the devotees. Bhaktya mam abhijanati. The real devotees, the pure devotees, they have revealed that. And Srila Govinda Maharaj has given very nice explanation on this. Before I discuss, do you have any questions or comments about that? What we are discussing here? Anybody have any questions or comments? Hmm. if there are no questions, then we are going to read today from here. This is Srila Govinda Maharaj, Revealed Truth, heart-to-heart transmission. From there we'll read. And Krishna Kinkar Prabhu, do you want to read it?
Sure, Maharaj.
Thank you very much, Prabhu. Dandavat.
Chapter 2, Heart-to-Heart Transmission. Question. We hear that all truth is present in the scriptures, specifically Srimad Bhagavatam. But how do we know when we are supposed to take the expressions in the scriptures literally or figuratively? How do we understand what the scriptures are really trying to say? Srila Govinda Maharaj, how will we understand anything about the scriptures? We must first enter into a school. When we are admitted into a school, we are given appropriate lessons for our level by our teacher. When I am studying in a school, I pass through class 1 to class 2, then to class 3, and so on. In each class, what I am taught is not exactly the same. Each higher class does not present everything in the same way as the previous classes do. But whatever I learn in each class is appropriate and beneficial for me at my level. The Vedas, Vedanta, Upanishads, Srimad Bhagavatam, and other scriptures are an ocean, and they contain so many verses which have many different meanings. Ultimately, they are all guiding us towards the same goal, Krishna Bhakti. But we are not always able to understand that. Sometimes it is very difficult to see that actually. Many different practicing devote processes are explained in the various scriptures. Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Ashtanga Yoga, Bhakti Yoga, and others. If we want to understand where the scriptures' knowledge is trying to take our consciousness, then it is first necessary to faithfully study the scriptural lessons that are appropriate for us in a school under the guidance of a proper teacher. That is the best process. We must be very conscious about reading the scriptures. The scriptures are not the easiest thing to understand. Srimad Bhagavad Gita explains how a student should approach a teacher to learn spiritual knowledge. Tat vidhi pranipatena pariprasnena sevaya upadekshyantite jnanam jnaninastattva darshinaha. Srimad Bhagavad Gita 4.34. Here it is explained that a student must be a little qualified to approach a teacher. Srimad Bhagavad Gita says, first be surrendered. First be surrendered and then inquire and serve. Your guru will want to hear your questions and bestow his mercy upon you. If you are really surrendered to him, you are humble and you have real hankering. First approach Gurudev through surrender, then serve him. Surrender alone is not sufficient. Surrendered service to Gurudev is the main thing that will give the sincere seeker the proper result in his search for transcendental knowledge. Someone may acquire general knowledge in other ways, but without pranipat, surrender, pariprashna, sincere inquiry, and seva, service, transcendental knowledge will not reveal itself in the heart. When a student is a little qualified in this way and finds a guru who is a qualified teacher, the student must surrender to him, ask him questions, and serve him. Everything will be revealed in the heart of the qualified sincere seeker, or the qualified guru, when the disciple is enriched with these three qualities of surrender, inquiry, and service, enriched with a mood of devotion. When that mood is present, everything will be set right. The guru's heart will be melted by the student's sincere approach, and the guru will be ready to teach the student. By this process, the student will understand, through the melted heart of his guru, the essence of all the scriptures. Everything that is to be found within the Vedas, Vedanta, Upanishads, Srimad Bhagavatam, and other scriptures. This is how we should try to learn the scriptures.
You understand what Gurudev is saying? Guru wants to give proper thing to us, but we have to be qualified in this way. There's qualities we must have. Three qualities. What are these three qualities? What Gurudev says? Remember? What are these three qualities?
Surrender, inquiry, and service.
Yes. And what is that surrender?
Dandavat Pranam Maharaj.
Dandavat?
Surrender is to surrender for the will of Sri Guru.
Yes. We don't want to give importance to our will. We want to give importance to the will under whom we are serving. What his will, what you want, what's not what I want this way, what you want. And only inquiry should be that, towards that port, that cause. Not that, how can I become the ruler? How can I become the knower? All those things. That is not going to help. And then service. When you know what Guru wants, then you serve. Serve that. So beautiful process. That is the way everything will come to you. No separate endeavor is necessary. No special endeavor is necessary.
It's a nice line, Shri Govinda Maharaj is saying, through the melted heart of the Guru.
Yes. Why it is melted heart?
He becomes pleased with the service mood of his devotee. His heart melts.
Yes. Actually, when Guru sees that somebody is willing to do what he is willing, then he becomes very happy. Radharani, that is the mood of Radharani. Radharani, if she sees somebody serving Krishna nicely, proper mood, and she wants to serve that. A guru never thinks himself as guru. A guru always thinks himself as disciple, actually. So, in that way, he's approaching also disciple as guru. Not that, he's thinking, I am all in all. Radharani is telling that. That is the mood of Radharani. If somebody can please Krishna properly, then I want to serve that devotee. Okay. Let's proceed.
Spiritual experts. We can see that the scriptures themselves always advise us about the position and necessity of the proper teacher, the sadhu. In Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, Srila Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami advises us, Chaha Bhagavatta Pada Vishnave Rastane, Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita Antya Leela 5.131. Go to the Vaishnava, the devotee, and hear from him the meaning of Srimad Bhagavatam. Only reach Srimad Bhagavatam in the association of the Vaishnavas. Without the Vaishnava, we cannot understand the meaning of Srimad Bhagavatam. And we will undoubtedly proceed in the wrong direction. It is necessary to hear the explanation of Srimad Bhagavatam or any scripture from some expert. Only when we hear from an expert can we understand the real meaning of Srimad Bhagavatam. Our knowledge is very limited. Nobody can say, I am full with all knowledge. Even Srila Guru Maharaj told us, I am a student. You consider yourselves masters, I consider myself to be a student, and all of you to be students. Nobody is a master.
So, you remember this? Once I told you, Sipat Puri Maharaj told this to those proud GBCs in ISKCON. They are thinking, do you accept our authorities as absolute? Do you accept GBCs as absolute? That's what they ask to Sipat Puri Maharaj after he takes sannyas from Srila Sridhar Maharaj. And Sipat Puri Maharaj told exactly this teaching of Srila Sridhar Maharaj to them. He told them that you are all considering yourself as absolute. That's why I consider you as relative. But Srila Sridhar Maharaj consider himself as relative. That's why I consider him as absolute. He thinks I am a student. I am not finished. I am not a finished product. Everything is done already. Then everybody must bow down to me. I am the greatest person. Nobody else is superior to me. That type of thing. How can it be seen as devotion? Even Mahaprabhu saying, I have not got it. Mahaprabhu saying that. What humility grass has, even I don't have. than are we thinking we are better than Lord? Krishna Anusilana Sangha. See, Chaitanya Saraswat Krishna Anusilana Sangha. Anusilana means student. They're all students. That mood. My Guru Maharaj, Mr. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Damodar Maharaj, told that. What he told was, we are always students. We never become perfect or masters. We're always students. We're always students. If that is forgotten, we may say in the lip those things, but we are not practicing that. That has no real value on us nor on the society. It will not be very much helpful. Okay, let's continue.
It was Srila Guru Maharaj's conception that we are all students. Therefore, we must strive to understand what our lessons are from a proper teacher. Through one who understands the essence of the lessons we are to learn, we can easily understand what our lessons are. It is very difficult to understand otherwise. We may make wrong interpretations, not understanding the real meaning of the scriptures, and we may be deceived. It is necessary to hear the meaning of Srimad Bhagavatam from a proper interpreter and servitor of Krishna, like Srila Guru Maharaj. Srimad Bhagavatam itself has given two formulas for understanding Srimad Bhagavatam. One prescribes reading Srimad Bhagavatam, and the other prohibits reading Srimad Bhagavatam. If somebody suddenly opens Srimad Bhagavatam and follows what comes in front of them, then they will proceed in the wrong way. It is necessary to harmonize the whole of Srimad Bhagavatam's conception. And who can harmonize it? Only one who knows the fundamental basis and full meaning of Srimad Bhagavatam.
Here,
there are so many. Yeah.
There are some contradiction you will find in scriptures. The Lord all saying, oh, all are going in one direction, going like this. Krishna's pastimes are crooked. Now his ways are crooked. It's not all straight. So you will be greatly perplexed if you go ahead like that. And you will lose your faith. Oh, I don't like these scriptures. They're all saying all the inconsistent. They're not consistent. Huh? How is that? Here it is saying like this and there it is saying like this. The opposite. How it is like this? You will be perplexed. You will lose your faith. You will be sahajya. You may go into so many directions. Mayabad. So many directions you may go. Karma Mishra Bhakti. Gyan Mishra Bhakti. But to see things, you need that proper telescope, what Govinda Maharaj used to say, telescopic system, proper telescope. By that, you can see a distant object, which is very beyond, you know, your direct sense, perception, your knowing ability. And yet, through that instrument of the, you know, descending chain of succession, you can see everything clearly. So thank you, Krishna Kinkar Prabhu. And who are here? Dandavat Tripad Prabhu.
Dandapran Maharaj. Sorry Maharaj, net is problem. Little bit disconnecting.
Okay. Can you read?
Yes Maharaj.
Okay. From this paragraph, there are so many things.
Yes, Maharaj.
Okay. Thank you, Prabhu.
There are so many things written in the scriptures and they are no doubt very good things. But because we have limited knowledge, we can also easily misunderstand the words of the scriptures. We must discuss the scriptures with a sadhu to clarify that we are understanding the scriptures properly.
We have to clarify. Not just we read and become very happy or sad or excited. We have to clarify from my dear devotee, sir, or sadhu, or Gurudev, Vaishnav. I'm reading like this. My blunt understanding going this way. Can you tell me? Is this correct thing? And that also, we do it. If sadhu has asked us to read the scripture, not that we simply come reading something and, you know, trying to disturb the Vaishnava like that. We do it in a mood of service. And not Sadhu has asked us to read something, Vaishnava has asked us to read something, Gurudev asked us to read something. Then we read it under the direction. Then we develop the spiritual understanding of that. Otherwise, we will only develop mundane understanding, material understanding of things. You understand, all of you, this important point?
Yes, ma'am.
Very important point. Never try to understand things, Krishna and his message, directly like that. You will be deceived by that. Okay, let's continue.
Yes, ma'am. Satam prasangan mama virya samvido bhavanti bhavanti hirutkarma rasayanaha kataihi tajjosnat aswa aparvarga vartamani sraddharatir bhaktir anukramishyati. Srimad Bhagavatam, 3rd canto, 25th chapter, 25th verse. The Lord himself explains in Srimad Bhagavatam, discussions about me heard in the association of my pure devotees nourish your ears and hearts. They fill your souls with ecstasy. Only when someone proceeds in their spiritual life under the guidance of my devotees will they naturally develop proper faith, attachment and devotion.
So faith, attachment and devotion. Three things you will lose if you go by your own to read scripture. Three things you will lose. Your faith will be lost, your attachment will be lost, and your devotion will be lost. And opposite also true. If you come and learn from the Sadhu Guru Vaishnavas in a mood of service, then your faith will be ever strong, strengthened, and you'll develop attachment, asakti. It's not that, you know, you are doing it in a forceful way. Oh, I have to do, I'm doing. I have to chant, I'm chanting. You develop an attachment for chanting. And you will develop love. Devotion means love. Serving with some love. That type of thing will come in your life. Okay. Continue, Tripath Prabhu.
Yes, what is written in books and what is heard directly from the sadhu are two completely different things. What we may read or hear outside the association of sadhu is not kritkarna rasayana kataihi. Nectarian words which nourish our hearts and fill us with ecstasy. Only when we hear from the sadhu are we receiving something in the proper channel, receiving something descending down from Goloka Vrindavan through the hearts of our paramparas, gurus, which is perfect and necessary for our spiritual life. Only when we hear in the proper channel from the sadhu is there a transmission of the power which reveals the essence of the scriptures. Scriptures words in our hearts. We are given real entrance into what we hear in the scriptures by the sadhu. Following the great voice.
What is there in the scripture, and yet sadhu is saying from the scriptures, that two different things. Gurudev says here. What is written in books and what is heard directly from the sadhu are two completely different things. Say in the starting of that paragraph. How?
Dhanavad Pranam Maharaj, because sadhu realize the inner meaning of scriptures.
You know something called Tanmatra? Anybody heard? Dhanavad Ramananda Prabhu?
Dhanavad Maharaj.
Dhanavad. Happy to meet you, have your association again. So, this Tanmatra are the sense objects. The matter is coming from that also. Tan matra. Matter. Matter is coming there from that. So we have only ability to access tan matra. But it is being told there is no difference between Srimad Bhagavatam and the Lord. There is no difference. But because we don't have the senses, you know, there is one sloka that we were, you know, reading before, Srila Rupa Goswami's. Sevan Mukhi Jivadau Swayam Eva Spurat Pada. Sri Krishna Namadi Navabhyat Gayet. That the Lord's, you know, holy name cannot be grasped by the blunt senses. But even your senses are, you know, Sevan Mukhi, completely absorbed in service, serving senses. Then you can taste Krishna. You can see Krishna. You can smell everything related to that. But not with the enjoying attitude. Not with the attitude of, you know, renunciation. That will not be helpful. So when you are trying to approach scriptures with your material, present material conditioning, then that and what sadhu is seeing through that scripture is completely different thing. You understand these two differences, all of you? Same thing can be seen by two people, and yet the two things, they what they are seeing, same object differently. Is it not possible?
It's possible.
Yes, it's possible.
Because it's unidimensional. It's Achintya Bheda Bhed. So everybody have their own perspective and level of consciousness. So they perceive accordingly.
Yes, Sivat Puri Maharaj explains, when you say, I see, that means what? I see means not that you just see it. When you say I see, that means you are, you know, by your knowledge, you are seeing. You are seeing the sun is moving from east to west. But you say, no, sun is fixed. Earth is moving. But that I see means you're not seeing through your eyes. You're seeing through your knowledge. So the knowledge that you have, then that vision is according to that. When your knowledge changes, your vision changes. So sadhu has some higher knowledge, pragyan, higher knowledge. So that vision is completely different than ours, you know, what we are seeing, the scripture or our understanding, everything completely different. Okay. Thank you, Tripad Prabhu.
Thank you,
Ramananda Prabhu, do you want to read from this, following the great souls?
I don't have the book.
No, it is there in the screen. Can you see in the screen?
Yes, I can. Yeah.
Yeah.
Where do you want me to read, Maharaj?
Following the great souls. Can you see that? Following the great souls.
Yes, Maharaj.
Yes. Thank you.
Thanks. Following the great souls, Yudhishthira Maharaj was a wise man. He was very qualified and had studied so many scriptures, the Vedas, Vedanta, Upanishads, and so on. He also received much advice from various rishis and munis. But after studying so many things, he was puzzled and could not find a settled position. Everything is good. Everything is bad. It is good. It is bad. It is good. It is bad. It is good. It is bad. Yudhishthira Maharaj could not conclude what was the proper way to get relief from the illusory environment and become established in a clean position. Lastly, he could only conclude that anyone who tries to discover what religion is simply by reading the scriptures will become crazy.
That is the realization of a great Mahajan, huh? Yudhishthira Maharaj. Okay. So we should not try to become crazy. Okay, Prabhu, please continue.
Sure. कारको प्रतिष्ठा श्रुतो विभिन्न नाश्या ऋषि यस्य मतः न भिन्न धर्मस्य ततम निहितम गुह्यम महाजनो येन गुह्यायम गुहायम या थैंक यू महाजनो येन गथा सुपंथ महाभारत वानपुराण 313-117 Yudhishthira Maharaj said, we cannot take the advice from the Vedas directly. Our store of knowledge is very limited. And the knowledge given in the Vedas is very vast. The Vedas explain pratyaksha gyan, sensory knowledge, roksha gyan, collective knowledge, aparoksha gyan, subtle knowledge, and adokshaja gyan, transcendental knowledge. Also the rishi who describe Vedic knowledge present many different interpretations of it and are not always perfect. Prasya rishi represented one conception, Vishishta rishi presented another, Chavan rishi presented another, and so on. There are so many rishis, and they presented many different conceptions. Thus, the jiva souls become. Thank you. Confused. They do not find the truth within the scripture, within only the scriptures. The differing opinions of the rishis and their own minds. To find the proper conception, we must follow the path of the Mahajans, the great souls in whose hearts the truth is living.
Yes. This is the conclusion of Yudhishthira Maharaj. We should not fight with each other. Oh, I read the book. My understanding is correct. And other person, no. I read like this. And this is correct. And we are fighting with each other. Even in Vaishnava community. No. This is what Gurudev has said. No. This is what Gurudev said. No. This is what another person is saying. No. That is not the way to fight with each other. You have to go to a higher Vaishnava, qualified Vaishnava. And hear from that Vaishnava and try to harmonize under that Vaishnava. That is the Vaishnava principle. That is the way to understand things. Not with ego class, fighting with each other, killing each other, becoming so much arrogant. That is not the process of Vaishnavism. You have to go to higher personality. When there are some doubts, different entities, they develop them. It is possible time and again. Then there is Vishva Vaishnava Rajasava. They are all clarifying truth from Rupa Goswami. They are going to Rupa Goswami like that. They are not just fighting with each other like that. Ego class, that is not the Vaishnava process. So, thank you Ramananda Prabhu.
Thank you, Maharaj. It's my pleasure.
Hare Krishna. Kanupriya Didi, do you want to read?
Dhanavat Maharaj.
Dhanavat. Yes. Didi. Thank you.
Svayambhur Naratha Sambhu Kumaraha Kapilo Manoho Prahalado Janako Bhishmo Vale Vayashake Vayam Srimad Bhagavatam 6.320. In Srimad Bhagavatam, Vedavyas indicated that Brahma, Narad Rishi, Shiva, the four Kumaras, Sanaka, Sanatan, Sananda, and Sanat, Kapiladev, Manu, Prahlad Maharaj, Janaka Raja, Bhishmadev, Bali Maharaj, Shukadev Goswami, and Yamaraj are all Mahajans. These particular 12 Mahajans are described throughout the scriptures and are so glorious. Their primary qualification is that they are all devotees of the Lord. Actually, all great devotees of the Lord should be considered Mahajans.
Once many of these... There is a song. You heard that song? Nadiya gadrume nityananda mahajan pati ache nam hat jivero karan. You heard this song? Mahajan.
Yes, I have heard.
Yes, so Mahajan. They are not ordinary John. It is Mahajan. They have awakened already their love in their heart beyond surrender. Not even surrender, beyond surrender. They have developed a loving relationship with the Lord. So we have to humbly go and solve our conflicts from them, what they have to conclude. Like Sukadev solved all conflicts and he said, Ante Narayana Smuti. Everybody accepted, yes. That's we will accept. And Sukadev is saying like that. So many people giving different advice. But Sukadev, whatever he told, that is accepted. Okay, Didi, please continue.
Once many of these 12 Mahajans who are listed in Srimad Bhagavatam were discussing a verse from Srimad Bhagavad Gita about the position of the Lord's devotees, but they could not come to a proper conclusion about it. In the meantime, they saw Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur going by, and they called him over, O Vaishnava Thakur, you know the proper meaning of this verse. Please come and join us. Then Bhaktivinoda Thakur explained the verse to them, and they were very happy. Devotees like Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur are the greatest Mahajans, and anyone who follows their guidance will be supremely benefited. Lapas tesham kyayash. Tesham kutash tesham prabhavaha yesham indivara shamo hridaye staho janardanaha. Pandava Gita, sorry, writing small. Bhagavan Sri Krishna is living in an effulgent way within the hearts of his dear devotees. And his pastimes are always going on there, very gloriously. Such devotees are truly great souls, Mahajans, and are always happy and successful. All directions should lead us towards Lord Krishna and the real Mahajans, Lord Krishna's pure devotees. We must follow a proper devotee whose activity is top to bottom, dedicated to Lord Krishna's service. His practice and lifestyle will be the perfect example of religious life for us. And his guidance will give us the proper understanding of the scriptures. Discussing the scriptures with qualified Vaishnavas, pure devotees, sadhus, is always the best thing for practitioners. Practitioners know something, no doubt, but they do not know everything. When they discuss scriptural matters with love and affection with a qualified sadhu, then they must be benefited by that. Realization of the proper meaning, feeling, and everything will come to them.
Gurudev also telling the same thing, what Sarudamodar Maharaj told. So don't try to read the brain book to become a brain surgeon. You have to serve under a surgeon. Brain surgeon, to become a brain surgeon, same way. The scriptures, they cannot be understood theoretically by reading, but when you hear from the realized saint, qualified saint, sadhu, then you will develop proper meaning, feeling, and everything. What is that everything?
The prem chakshu, see, like we sing a song, prema bhakti jaha hoite avidya vinash jate, ved gaye jaha rachrito.
Yes.
Actually, we have all the knowledge, everything, but it's covered up because of ego. Yes.
So we will get Krishna consciousness, Krishna prem, Krishna consciousness. And Krishna conscious person, he understands everything naturally. So when our Krishna consciousness awakened, then we can understand. That is everything. By that we can satisfy Lord, his devotees, everything. So, very important thing. Thank you, Kanupriya Didi. Madan Mohan Prabhu. Madan Mohan. Yes.
Krishna Maharaj.
Krishna Kinkar Prabhu. Yes. You wanted to say something?
I just want to ask something, that discussion between some of the Mahajanas and Bhaktivinoda Thakur.
Yes.
Is the discussion recorded somewhere? Bhaktivinoda Thakur's reply to them?
Yeah, I think he replied about, Apichesu Durachari, that sloka.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. How can that such person also, we see good in him? Bhaktivinoda Thakur given some explanation on that to them. And they all agree to that. And great authority, Bhaktivinoda Thakur. The Guru Maharaj also discussed that. Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he discovered Mahaprabhu's birthplace. And yet, he was not proud that, yes, this is what I'm saying, you must accept it. No. Even taking the authority of Jagannathas Babaji Maharaj, he took him there. And when Babaji Maharaj gives approval, then he accepts it. He also follows that. It's not that, everybody accepts him Mahajan, then he also setting an example like that. Bhaktivinoda Thakur. So that is the mood of a devotee, a Vaishnava. That's why everything, inner secrets are revealed in his heart, actually, of such devotees. Madan Mohan Prabhu, do you want to read?
Sure, Maharaj.
Thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Religion of the heart. When Krishna wants to reveal transcendental knowledge in your heart through his devotees, it must be revealed. Even you won't be able to check it. So we need connection with Krishna's devotees. Thus the actual question is, how can we recognize a genuine devotee, a true religious person? To whom does Krishna reveal himself? The first verse to explain this, which explains the theme of our book, Religion of the Heart, must be Vidvadbhi sevita sadbhir nityam advesha raghabhi hridayane hridayana bhyanu gyato yo dharmastam nibodhata. Manu Samhita 2.1. Srila Guru Maharaj once gave a lecture in the library of Dhanbad before a gathering of many highly qualified pandits and wealthy persons. He started his lecture with this verse. He explained that people think religion is found in books and that those books are written in particular language. But the religion does not actually come from the book, from books or languages. Religion is communicated through the transcendental language of heart transaction. All religion presented in scriptures is first revealed in the hearts of rishis, munis, and sadhus. After it appears in their hearts, it is transmitted forward from heart to heart, and it later may take the form of books. So what we can say about religion? How much can we understand it? It is a matter of heart. How can we feel the beauty and understand the glory of religion if our hearts are presently as filthy as a dustbin? Because our hearts are impure, we must try to understand religion from a clean-hearted sadhu.
Such a nice explanation Gurudev is giving. And he's saying it must be transmitted from heart to heart. How that happens? Heart to heart. How that happens?
Shabad Brahman through Shabad Brahman. Parampara.
Heart to heart. My Guru Maharaj used to say, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Damodar Maharaj, both envy and devotion, both can transfer heart to heart. You understand? Envy and devotion, both. Wrong things and proper things. Both can be transferred heart to heart. And that happens through association. When you are trying to take some conception from somebody, and that person is envious nature, you're trying to associate with him, as we have told. There are six kinds of association. Remember the six kinds of association? Mm-hmm. Giving gift, taking gifts, revealing our mind, and listening from the other person's mind, and offering prasad, taking prasad, like this. If we do the with wrong persons, all these things, then we will develop wrong things. But same thing, if we do with sadhus, with Vaishnav, in higher quarter, then the same, that conception will also come to our heart. Narad Rishi, he simply taken prasadam from those saints who visited his mother's place, and he got it. Simply taking their remnants, he got that. So it is through our association, heart to heart, those concepts are transferred. You don't have to do anything. Dibya Gyan Hride Prakashito. Dibya Gyan Hride Prakashito. So if you are properly associating, then those things will come to our heart naturally. Madan Manpu, thank you very much.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Uma Didi, do you want to read?
Yes, quality of yes sadhu. What are the quality of yes sadhu? Vidvadvi Savita Sadvir. A perfect sadhu cleanly and clearly understand the Vedas. The Vedanta and the essence of their directive. Vidvadiha. He always serves their purpose. Sevita. He has no deficiency in simplicity, clean lines, or proper behavior. Sadbir. He has control of his six essences, and he has regard for everyone. He only sadness is the suffering of others.
So these are the very important qualities of the sadhus. He has control over his senses. His control over senses means not that he stopped his senses. Like Mahatma Gandhi has those monkeys. You might have seen those monkeys closing their eyes, ears, all those things. You might have seen that, right? Sadhu is not like that. His control over his senses means he is completely free from any enjoying spirit or renouncing spirit. Has developed, has cultivated serving senses. And he has regard for everyone. He is not thinking that I am the greatest person. He is willing to give regard to everybody by taking the lower position. That is only possible in that stage. When you take a lower position. And he only saddens to see the suffering of others. Paro dukhe dukhi. That is the nature of the sadhu. Okay, Didi, please continue.
Okay. Vedavyasa, the author of all the Vedas, scriptures, was the true sadhus. He saw so many other sadhus and was also praised by so many sadhus. He knew everything about revealed knowledge, but more.
Revealed knowledge.
But more so than knowledge and even behavior. What did he say was the best quality of sadhu? Nirmata Saranam Satyam.
Nirmata Saranam Satam.
Nirmat सहनम सत्यम
सताम
सतम सतम श्रीमद् भागवत गीता 1.1
श्रीमद् भागवतम
भागवतम 1.1.2
This is the second verse of Bhagavatam. You always reminded this. What is the quality of the sadhu to enter into Bhagavatam? This is what Gurudev is saying that. Okay, Didi, please read.
The sadhu's heart is completely clean and clear. There is not even a tiny dirty thing within it. This means that the sadhu is never envious of others. Nityam Advesa Ragibhiya. He was no enviousness or anger and holds full love and affection within his heart for everyone. A sadhu with these qualities, who is fully attached to Krishna consciousness, is a real Mahajan, a real leader of humanity, and is always rightly engaged in religious service. Krishna Bhakta Nishkama Adeva Santa Bhukti Mukti Siddhi Kami Sakali Asanta Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhya Leela 19.149.
Thank you, Uma Devi.
One who is interested in the mundane selfish enjoyment, liberation or supernatural power is not a sadhu. One who wish no desire for selfish enjoyment, who want to give rather selfish enjoyment, liberation or supernatural power is not a sadhu. One who has no desire for selfish enjoyment, who want to give there rather than take, who is always engaged 24 hours a day in service the desire of the Divine Lord, is a sadhu. He alone is a truly peaceful, perfect gentleman. Really, religion is the beauty that appears within the heart of such a sadhu. The transcendental feeling revealed in a sadhu heart through his life of service. Whatever advice and interaction such a sadhu expresses is through religious interaction, introduction and can never be harmful to anyone. If we will receive a heart transmission from that type of sadhu and follow his guidance, we must feel the benefit of truly religious life and come to understand the universal religion of all souls, Jiva Dharma. If anyone will proceed according to the guidance of a pure sadhu, then from that launching pad, they will happily fly into the sky of
virtue
and reach the peak of religion. There is no party spirit of certain interest.
Sectarian
interest in such pure religion.
Do you all understand what Gurudev is saying here? This sloka. You know this sloka? Krishna Bhakta Niskam Atev Santo. Bhukti Mukti Siddhi Kami Sakliya Sant Chaitanya Charitamrit. Sriman Mahaprabhu is telling to Rupa Goswami, the quality of a devotee of the Lord is this: Krishna Bhakta Niskam. He has no other desire. Atayab Santo. So he is peaceful. All others, Bhukti Mukti Siddhi Kami Sakliya Sant. And that type of Krishna consciousness has no sectarian ground. As Gurudev is saying, sectarian. You know what is the meaning of this sectarian? Anybody knows?
Maharaj, is it to think that one's way is the only way?
Yes. saying that, oh, Lord can only be there in my deity. He cannot be in your deity. Lord is there only in my deity. My guru is the only guru. Your guru is not the guru. Only this devotee can be the devotee of the Lord, and others, they are not the devotees of the Lord. This type of sectarian idea, sectarian conception, that is enemy to the, you know, society, and also that is not the spirit of Vaishnavism. That is not, actually. Krishna can appear in unlimited deities as he is. He can. He can come through sadhu, then he can come through many, many sadhus, actually. And that if we can see Krishna properly, then we can realize how Krishna is manifesting even in water. I was telling before, my Guru Maharaj told, Sarvadamodara Maharaj, he told me that the scientists are saying water is just H2O, but Krishna is saying, I am the taste in the water. Krishna is there as taste in the water, but are we seeing that? Are we seeing that Krishna there? We are thinking, we are so proud. We are thinking that Krishna can be only in certain way. We can limit Krishna like that. But Krishna is not like that, limited. Who has developed the proper vision, premanjana churita bhakti vilosaneno, then he can see Krishna in everything. He can relate everything in connection with Krishna. Mahaprabhu, even seeing, whenever he sees cow, immediately he remembers Krishna. He's seeing some the reflection of moon in the water of the Jagannath Puri ocean, and he's jumping it as Jamuna. That type of thing. Everything, they're only seeing Lord there. That type of vision has to be developed, not a sectarian vision. Oh, Krishna cannot come anywhere else, can only come here. It's not like that. So when we hear proper conception from a Vaishnava or genuine Vaishnava, then we overcome all this misconception of sectarianism, envy, false pride, all those things. Proper humility will be established. And that's what is the necessity. Thank you very much, Uma Didi. Sumala Didi, do you want to read? Your mic is muted.
Yes, Dandavat Pranam Maharaj.
Dandavat.
A universal religion. After Srila Guru Maharaj's lecture, in which he made many of these points about true religion, one very well-to-do man in the audience spoke, in the past, we have heard about a Vaishnava Dharma, and we considered that Vaishnava Dharma was a branch of Hindu Dharma. But I am so satisfied with what I have heard from Srila Sridhar Maharaj that I now understand that all religious property is present within Vaishnava Dharma. I now know that Vaishnava Dharma is one. It is the true universal religion, and all other dharmas are some part of Vaishnava Dharma. I feel now that the universal Vaishnava Dharma is the best thing for all Jiva souls. Srila Guru Maharaj's style was always very broad and perfect. He was always conscious about what he was doing, and he always presented everything according to the scriptures politely with clear logic. Some sannyasi and brahmacharis would present our Param Gurudev's conception, Srila Saraswati Thakur's conception, in a hammering way. But Srila Guru Maharaj was completely different from them. I am fortunate that I have heard many things from Srila Guru Maharaj. I have seen that so many people received divine light from him, and that this light became the light of their life.
Hammering way. What is the meaning of hammering way? Anybody knows?
Aggressive words, Maharaj?
Yes. You have all know one incident that happened in Dhaka, I think. One devotee who is supposed to be a godbrother of Sridhar Maharaj, and he told there, Vivekananda is a gunda and Ramakrishna is a bhanda pujari, and that's supposed to be the gathering of all Mayavadis, Ramakrishna Mission people. And they all wanted to beat these people who came to that panda. And then, you know, somebody requested Sridhar Maharaj, you know, that Maharaj, please you go and, you know, tell something. And then when Sridhar Maharaj, he spoke, and then he said, Maharaj, whatever you spoke, that other person also spoke the same thing. But your speaking is so soothing to heart, so much, you know, touching to the heart. And then when other person was speaking like this, it was like, you know, creating so much disturbance in our heart. Like that, he told. But when devotees came and told this incident to Saraswati Thakur, he appreciated Sridhar Maharaj also. But also he told that other person who told that Vivekananda is a gunda and Ramakrishna is a bhanda pujari. He told he did my 1 lakh rupees job there. So you know, the devotee sometimes uses his passion, his things, and it comes up in a very you cannot, you know, conceive how things comes up. But all those things are mercy to this world, Vaishnava's mercy in this world. However, Mahaprabhu's mood is to present everything with honor and respect. That is very important. But Nityananda's mood is more aggressive, forceful. No, you have to become devotee. It's not that you will be escaping. No, you have to be. That is Nityananda's mood. And Mahaprabhu's mood is more soft, more, you know, philosophically, you know, thoughtful way. Like this, you will find, you know, different moods of devotees. And Srila Govinda Maharaj expressing those things here. Okay, let's continue.
The law of love and affection. My life in Sri Chaitanya Saraswat Math with Srila Guru Maharaj was always very restricted. I would not do anything without the permission of Srila Guru Maharaj. At least I can say for myself that I never did anything that Srila Guru Maharaj did not give me permission to do. When the property of Sri Chaitanya Saraswat Math was in a critical position, I had to go to Kalna every day for 2 months to defend the mutt in court. Each day I would travel from the mutt to the court in the Kalna and return home, but I would not go anywhere else along the way. One day Srila Guru Maharaj asked me, have you seen the temple of Gauridas Pandit in Kalna? I said that I had lived near the temple all my life, but that I had never once seen the temple. Srila Guru Maharaj said, next time you go to Kalna, offer your Dandavat Pranam to Mahaprabhu and Nityananda Prabhu there. It was only then that I ever visited that temple. Also, I never visited Mahaprabhu's sannyas place, Katwa, for 28 years until I received the service order of Srila Guru Maharaj. Our life was very restricted under Srila Guru Maharaj, but we actually never felt any restriction. We always felt everything to be the natural love and affection of Srila Guru Maharaj. We felt that our service life was guided by Srila Guru Maharaj and we could simply and happily follow his orders. That was a natural law of Sri Chaitanya Saraswat Math. Everyone would follow the rules automatically with love and affection. It is always best when people will follow religious rule and regulations naturally with love and affection, with respect and honor. This was the standard we followed in Sri Chaitanya Saraswat Math from the beginning, and we never felt the necessity for anything else. In that environment, I heard from Srila Guru Maharaj for many years and learned something about the essence of the scriptures, the essence of religion through him.
Joy, Srila Bhakti Sundar Govinda Dev Goswami Maharaj ki jai. So, Srila Gurudev has given such beautiful explanation about the real meaning of the religion and how it is revealed. It's not just from the books that we can get it. And following the principles in the mat is a natural thing. It is not a forceful thing that every day you have to give one, you know, presence, attendance by putting your thumb on the there is a scanner that how many days in a month you attended Mangal Arati, how many days you did certain things. All these things is not by a mechanical process, but it's all being done with love and with care. So that is the principle of Sri Chaitanya Saraswat Math, and with non-sectarian mood. Chaitanya Saraswat mood is to give honor to everyone, give honor to proper honor to everyone from all quarters. If there is something good is there, you must recognize it, irrespective of its where it is coming from. We must take that with much appreciation. So, anybody has any questions or comments about what has been discussed today? Anything to say or anything to ask?
Can I ask something, Shantamara?
Yes, Prabhu. We're not seeing your video. Your beautiful face.
Sorry about that.
Yes. That was... Seeing your laughing face, all are becoming transcendental. Laughing face.
Gurudev's mercy. Gurudev used to tell all the time, smile. Yeah. You can't have it implanted.
Yes, Prabhu.
Yeah, I was listening to Srila Guru Maharaj. I watched Guru Maharaj's video about harmony. So he said, because all conception can be harmonized by real sadhu like yourself. He talks about adhyaya gyan. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, yes. Please repeat the last sentence, last word. I could not hear. What you say?
Advaya gyan.
Advaya gyan. Advaya gyan. Yes. Advaya gyan.
Yeah.
Yes. So, actually, this world, material world, we are experiencing duality. There is opposite things. And we have no way to have a harmony, the unity, to understand those things. What is the unity? The opposition may be there. And then whatever in a proper is there, there must be some opposition. But what is the harmony to that? You see, there is Mahamaya is there and there is Jogamaya is also there. Mahamaya is making you forget of Krishna, and Yogamaya is always making you remember of Krishna. So you are not seeing them as a conflict, something. But you see, both are energies of the Krishna, and they are serving the function of the Krishna. Yogamaya serving a function in the spiritual world, and Mahamaya serving a purpose in the material world. And Mahamaya is a reflection of that, Yogamaya, is expansion. So, harmony can be established by Krishna when it is centered around Krishna. Absolute can harmonize all contradictory things. Absolute can harmonize it. It is not an artificial harmony. So many people are doing peace conference. Even they don't know what is peace and harmony. But they are doing that. See, what is the definition of peace? My Harinam Gurudev, Srila Bhakshu Damodar Maharaj, he told that when your senses are not bothering you, then you are in peace. When your senses are not bothering you, not disturbing you. But how that senses can be placed in that stage is not going to happen by maintaining the presence in the dual world. So you have to go to non-dual plane, that is the transcendental world. There is nothing like matter and life. That everything is conscious. Everything is chinmoy. And there is, this conception of, the self that we have here. And there is non-self. But there, everything is related to one self, that is Krishna. And yet, there are other selves up there, but they are only in relation to Krishna as serving self. There is no separate self there. The individuality is not eliminated. The diversity is maintained. And yet, they're all united as the serving units. But here, everybody is an isolated. Oh, this is my house, that is your house. This is my property, that is your property. This is my religion, that is your religion. Like this, so many different varieties of, you know, egos are manifested. But all egos melted there. Centered around Krishna, there is one ego, that is the servitude. There, even opposition can be a servitor there, serving. Those who are opposing the devotee there, they are also enhancing devotee's mood of dedication. They are serving devotee there. They are actually, you are eating the fruit, apple, and apple is becoming happy. The devotee is, you know, using me. But here, you are eating apple and apple is becoming angry. You are getting the body of apple next life, karma. But there, everything is for, you know, God-centered life. Everything is united under the absolute. The unity is established. So, the duality of pain, pleasure, all these things that we are experiencing, sufferings, birth, death, everything can be overcome if we develop love for the absolute. Seva, sukha, dukha, parama, sampada, nasai, avidya, dukha. That is the way of transcending this world. Seva, sukha, dukha. In service also, there is a pain and there is pleasure. But that destroys, that is our wealth actually. And that destroys the service mentality with love, that destroys the suffering coming from pain and pleasure of the duality. Seva, sukha, dukha, parama, sampada, nasai, avidya, dukha. Ignorance. Duality is coming from our ignorance, avidya. So if we can see properly, sukhe, dukhe, bhulo, nako, sada, hari, bole, dako. Don't be so much absorbed with this sukha, dukha of this world. Sita atapa bata barisana edina jamini jagire bhipale sevino kripana durjana chapala sukhala balage. For the senses, we are so much entrapped in this duality, changing nature of this world, serving so many rascals actually, durjan, for mere sense gratification. Edhana jovana putra parijana eteki ache parati tire. But they are so great. Happiness in this wealth, family members, youth, all these things. Jivana talamala, kamala dala jala, jivana talamala. Bhajau haripada nitire, niti, always. Whether you are going towards death or taken birth, does not matter. Always you chant, always you engage in yourself in service. Nitya, come to the transcendental platform. Always develop a vision of seeing good in others. In that way, you will not be trapped with the duality of the defects of this world. See the good in others and ignore other person. That is transcendental quality. Lord and the devotees, they are adosadarshi. They don't see the defects. They only see the good. That is the way to transcend this world, this material world of duality. Always seeing good, even somebody cursing us, Mahaprabhu, somebody cursed Mahaprabhu, your material life will be finished. It will be a problem in your material life. Then people generally, somebody curse you, your family life will be troubled. They say, oh, what kind of curse he is giving like this? Mahaprabhu saying, oh, this is a boon to me. Thank you very much, my dear Brahmana. Thank you very much. This is the boon. Parikshit Maharaj got a curse and he made it a boon. The suffering condition of Prahlad Maharaj, it became a boon. Everything lost by Bali Maharaj, but that became a boon to Bali Maharaj. He got the highest by that. You see, Lord satisfaction. He not consider what he is losing. Even his guru was thinking, oh, Vishnu will take away everything. But Bali Maharaj could say, no, if everything belongs to Vishnu, if he comes to take, what's the problem? I'll give it to him. What's the problem? So that type of vision that devotees have. When we come to association of transcendental personalities, properly associate and serve under them, then we will become also transcendental. Like a fire come in touch, iron come in touch with fire, it becomes also like a fire. Like that. It's possible. You will not feel any pain and pleasure of this world. Sadhu sange man anandita anukhan sabha sada hai Krishna parasanga. You know that song? Anybody remember this song? Anybody know this song? It's a very beautiful song. Anandita anukhan sada hai Krishna parasanga. Very nice song. Let me see if I can. Yeah, I could find. This is by Sri Narottam Das Thakur. Okay. Let me share for all of you. Okay. We'll conclude our Sangha with this song. Thakura Vaishnava Pada Avanira Susampada Suna Bhai Hayai Kamana
Thakura Vaishnava Pada Avanira Susampada Suna Bhai Hayai Kamana
Asraya Laiya Bhaje Tare Krishna Nahi Teje Arsa More Akarana
Asraya Laiya Bhaje Tare Krishna Nahi Teje Arsa More Akarana
Vaishnava charana jala prema bhakti dite bala aar keho nahe bala bhanta
Vaishnava charana jala prema bhakti dite bala aar keho nahe bala
Vaishnava charana renu mastake bhusana binu ar nahi bhusanera anta
Vaishnava charana renu mastake bhusana binu ar nahi bhusanera anta
Tirtha jala pavitra gune liki ache purane se sab bhakti ra pravanchana
Tirtha jala pavitra liki ache purane
Vaishnavira pada duka samana hai isav jate hai banchita pura
Vaishnavira pada samana hai isav jate hai banchita pura
Vaishnava Sangete Mana Anandita Anukhana Sadahai Krishna Para Sangha
Vaishnava Sangete Mana Anandita Anukhana Sadahai Krishna Para sanga
dinanaratam kande hiyadharja nahi bande moro dasa keno hoilo bhanga ठाकुर वैष्णव पद अवनीर सुसंपद सुन भाई हया एक मन दयाल वैष्णव ठाकुर वैष्णव ठाकुर दयाल वैष्णव ठाकुर दयाल वैष्णव ठाकुर दयाल वैष्णव ठाकुर वैष्णव ठाकुर दयाल वैष्णव
ठाकुर
रामानंद प्रभु डू यू वांट टू रीड द ट्रांसलेशन
यस महाराज थैंक यू द वर्शिबल वैष्णवास फीट आर द ग्रेटेस्ट प्रेयर इन द वर्ल्ड ओ ब्रदर लिसन अटेंटिवली टेक शेल्टर ऑफ द वैष्णवास एंड सर्व कृष्णा डज नॉट रिजेक्ट वन हु डज सो ऑल अदर्स डाई इन वेन
सो ऑलवेज सर्व अंडर द शेल्टर Narottam Das Thakur say, if you don't do that, you will die without even any cause.
The Vaishnava's foot water has the power to give one prema bhakti. Nothing else has such power. I wear no ornament on my head other than the Vaishnava's foot dust. The pure.
Yes, Prabhu, please continue.
Thank you. The purifying power of water of places of pilgrimage has been described in the Puranas. Such statements are a devotional trick. Water from pilgrimage site is never equal to the Vaishnava's foot water, which fulfills all of one's desires. My mind is always joyful in the company of the Vaishnavas, where discussion of Krishna is always happening. Humble Narottam cries, my heart has no patience. Why has my condition changed? Why have I lost the Vaishnavas association?
Do you understand Ramananda Prabhu? Here he says, my mind is always joyful in the company, always. That transcends the duality. He will be always joyful in the company of the Vaishnavas. Because they always discuss Krishna consciousness, Krishna katha. So then we don't have any maya katha. We don't have to bother about all these mundane things. Narottam Das Thakur has given that solution. How to transcend this dual world and enter into non-dual world. अद्वय जगत जय नरोत्तम दास ठाकुर की जय
जय
anybody has any other questions or comments
I have one more question actually yes. It's related to same video
yes
so guru maharaj telling there one can help reconnect with the transcendental world one sadhu who is not deviated or who is pure sadhu.
Yes, of course. Sadhu is not by dress or a chair. It's not by that. It's not about body. A doctor's son cannot be a doctor guaranteed like that. If that is the case, then it will be a Jat Gosai. You know, that is one of the Sahajya Sampradaya. Jat Gosai. Ours is not like that. It may come anywhere in a zigzag way. Guru Maharaj says that. It comes in a zigzag way. Inconceivable way, actually. So, the deviance happens in the conception. It does not happen in the through the lineage. It happens in the conception. If the proper conception is forgotten and given the importance to outward things, to the buildings, to the followers, to the society, and Krishna consciousness is forgotten, then that is a great misfortune, actually. Great misfortune. They miss the soul and only body. Jesus told, if you get the whole world, but you lost your soul, then what you gain? Sivak Puri Mara many times remind us. You get whole world, but you lost your soul. What's the game? You have so many followers, building everything, but you have no conception of the previous acharyas, what they are stating. That is not properly followed. And everything is lost, actually. But we don't have anything. We are living, Siddhar Maharaj, living, having no buildings, no mat, no mission. In a small house. But he was carrying the entire wealth in his heart. Entire wealth in his heart he was carrying. So what should be our focus? What should be our focus? Outward things?
Inner wealth.
Yes.
Inner wealth, yeah.
Yes. And those who understand importance of that, then they will not be fanatic or sentimental. They will be humbly trying to serve to that function of Krishna where it is manifesting. And from that, everything will come to them. And others, those who are driven by the outward vision, they will get what they are looking. Krishna will give you what you are looking for. What you are looking for, you will get that. It's not the fault of Krishna. It's yours. You see what you want. You decide what you want. Or see in your heart what you are looking for. The outward things or the real, something concrete. That is the main thing. Is that okay, Ramananda Prabhu?
Yes, it's very beautiful. Thank you so much, Maharaj. No, I love it. Thank you. You make it real. See, I work with so many.
It's all given to us, explained to us by Sripad Bhakti Madhava Puri Maharaj.
Yeah.
All these things. He has learned it from Srila Sridhar Maharaj. And he has collected all these things. And Sridhar Maharaj used to say to him, I am like you.
Nice. You sound like awesome. You sound like a little bit like Puri Maharaj sometimes.
We are just, so nice. I am only an imitator. I am only an imitator, I feel. Actually, Srila Sridhar Maharaj says, he thinks his kirtan is like, you know, noise. Like in noise. He thinks like that. But the real thing is there.
Yeah, no, Guru Maharaj is real. He is so amazing. I listen, watch his video. So merciful.
But he never thought. I am the great man. Everybody must follow me. Everybody must listen me. He never thought like that.
Yeah.
He was willing to give honor. He was giving honor to his god brothers. He was giving honor to all devotees. That was the mood of Sri Chaitanya Saraswati Mat. Everybody, so many background people from so many mutts, even from other sampradaya, even gundas, even dacoits, they could feel happy to meet Sridhar Maharaj. They would feel easily feel that, oh, he is my real well-wisher. They would feel like that when you meet him. It's something genuine. Thank you very much, Ramananda Prabhu, for your all association and, you know.
No, thank you. Very grateful to you, Maharaj. I was lucky, actually, Gurudev came, visited his house. He came to our house many times, like Govinda Maharaj.
Very nice. Yeah. Yes. He's very merciful. you know,
very merciful guru.
He does not see, he does not see whether somebody has, you know, great building or, you know, small house. I have seen in Bengal, he visited even one devotee was there. Subir Prabhu, he used to do one festival annually. And Gurudev used to come to his house. Yeah. He's not seeing, you know, how much great facility you have or anything. He's only seeing that sincerity. You know that Lakshmi, whose house Ramanuj visited? Lakshmi has nothing actually, even to offer. She was wearing one cloth. She making it dry, staying naked, and once she dried that dress, then she was wearing that. Such poor she was. And yet when Ramanuja comes and what kind of service he did, it's quite amazing. So service does not depend on how much facility you have. Service depends on your mood of your heart. How much you have love for Guru Vaishnava. From there service will come. And Guru Vaishnava also sees that in others. They don't see your outward things. Your post, your position, or anything. Mahaprabhu was avoiding even King Pratap Rudra. But he stayed in that humble house, Gambira, given by, what is the name? Gambira is given by the devotee, Kashimishra. No, Kashimishra, no? Kashimishra. Kashimishra's house was a Kubja, and before Surpanakha, right? He became Kashimishra. The house Mahaprabhu stayed. Anybody have anything to say before we conclude? Any comments or questions? So, if there are no comments or questions, we are concluding our Sangha here today. Vancha kalpataru vasya kripa sindhu bhaye vacha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namo jai vishnupada paramansa paribrajaka jagadguru srila bhaksha damodar gosvami maharaj ki jai vishnupada paramansa paribrajaka jagadguru srila bhakti madhav puri maharaj ki jai vishnupada paramansa paribrajaka jagadguru srila bhakti nirmala acharya gosvami maharaj ki jai vishnupada paramansa paribrajaka jagadguru srila bhakti sundar govinda dev gosvami maharaj ki jai vishnupada paramansa paribrajaka jagadguru srila yesu bhaktan sam prabhupada ji maharaj ki jai vishnupada paramansa paribrajaka सच्चिदानंद भक्ति विनोद ठाकुर की जय वैष्णव सर्व जगन्नाथ बाबूजी महाराज की जय बलदेव विद्यावसन प्रभु की जय नरोत्तम दास ठाकुर की जय कृष्णदास कविराज गोस्वामी महाराज की जय वृंदावन दास ठाकुर महाशय की जय रूपानुग गुरु वर्ग की जय नामाचार्य हरिदास ठाकुर की जय प्रेम से बोले श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिव सदस्य गौर भक्त बिंद की जय सर्वदामोदर राम लदि भक्त बिंद की जय मुरारी गुप्त प्रभु की जय सपार्षद नित्यानंद प्रभु की जय सपार्षद महाप्रभु की जय भक्ति देवी वृंद देवी की जय गंगा देवी जमुना देवी की जय ग्रंथराज श्रीमद भागवतम की जय चैतन्य चरितामृत चैतन्य भागवत की जय भक्तराज प्रहलाद महाराज की जय शुद्ध भक्ति विज्ञान विनाशन भगवान नरसिंह देव की जय जय श्री जगन्नाथ बलदेव सुभद्र सुदर्शन जीव की जय जगन्नाथ धाम की जय मायापुर नवदीप धाम की जय अपराज भंजन पारसी कोलोदीप की जय जय श्री गुप्त गोवर्धन की जय जय श्री सदाशिव गंगाधर जीव की जय जय श्री मथुरा वृंदावन धाम की जय जय श्री श्याम कुंड राधा कुंड गिरी गोवर्धन की जय जय श्री चैतन्य सारस्वत मठ की जय तद्य विश्वव्यापी शाखा समूह की जय तद्य विश्वव्यापी सेवक बिंद भक्त बिंद की जय श्री चैतन्य सारस्वत इंस्टीट्यूट की जय प्रिंसटन भक्ति इंस्टीट्यूट की जय जय समवेद भक्त बिंद की जय श्रीपाद रामानंद प्रभु की जय श्रीपाद कृष्ण किंकर प्रभु की जय मदन मोहन प्रभु की जय उमा दीदी की जय सुमंगला दीदी की जय समवेद भक्त बिंद की जय कोल करताल की जय हरिनाम संकीर्तन की जय निताय गौर प्रेमानंदे हरि हरि बोल धन्यवाद एवरीवन
भक्ति निष्कामा शांता महाराज की
जय
जय गुरुदेव वी वर थिंकिंग दैट वी कुड हैव सम एक्सटेंडेड सेशन ड्यूरिंग रथ यात्रा डे बट सम अनफॉर्चुनेट न्यूज कमिंग दैट सुप्रीम कोर्ट ऑफ इंडिया इट हैज बैंड रथ यात्रा फॉर दिस ईयर And nowhere Rath Yatra can be observed, even including Puri. And there is a rule, it seems, if once Rath Yatra is stopped, it happens after 12 years in Jagannath Puri. So we're not sure if that's going to follow. In the next 12 years, we are not seeing Rath Yatra then in Puri. So hopefully, you know, we don't know that people are trying to still sort it out, all these things. So if there is some, you know, news coming, or there is Rath Yatra happening or not, if there is a possibility, then we can have some extended session. Otherwise, we can have, you know, short Sangha and the Rath Yatra. And also there is Gundisa Marjan is coming, so we can discuss also. Thank you very much for your participation. My humble Dandavat Pranam to all of you. Dandavat.